I think we're good. Thanks, Jeff.
Thank you. musicians. I love playing, and sometimes you just want to just kind of get it off your chest, a little carve it out, and I'll play a little bit today. I think we have brass, woodwind, strings, percussionists, all the music groups, instrumental groups available, including voice. And today, I guess we're talking about improvisation. What are we talking about today? Someone tell me, or we can start off with just questions.
I think the format was kind of open.
Say it again?
Format is kind of open. We can start with some questions.
Yeah. Well, yeah, let's start with some questions. I just want you to know everything that I play and what I'll probably talk about some today, if we get into improvisation, because I know sometimes that's a scary word for some. It's just a matter of us grasping the concept if we're unfamiliar with an approach to improvisation. And I find that singing for me has been a way to connect myself to my instrument, or to connect my instrument to me, because music actually comes from you. An instrument is an extension. I used to hear that all the time growing up, but I didn't really learn what that meant until I actually started singing. So, if it's a technique like double tonguing, if I can sing it, then I can play it. If it's a phrase like, singing is the one thing that has really helped me connect to the instrument, even some of the foolishness. I can't sing everything that I can play, but I try to, and I use my voice to try to sing things rhythmically and melodically, and even sing through harmonies. It helps me to be able to hear and to just connect with music a lot more in a much more expeditious fashion. Yes.
When did you figure out, I guess, like that singing, I guess, played this big role in playing the trombone? Because you're saying you didn't do it at the beginning. Mm-hmm. Is there like something that switched or changed your mind to be like, that's what I need to do?
Mm-hmm. I'm sorry, what's the question?
So like, what made you open yourself up to like singing? What was like, oh, I need to be like, singing is the thing that's gonna help me, or like, singing can help me?
Well, it may have been a series of events. I don't think it was just one thing.
Yeah.
But it became apparent to me. Like one time I was driving between Augusta, Georgia and Tallahassee, Florida, and I decided I was gonna work on my double tonguing, which is that type of tonguing. I mean, for trombonists, we don't have butts to push or valves. So in order to keep from getting the gliss, if the notes are moving down in the slide out or up in the slide, the notes going up and the slide coming in, we'll get a gliss like. So double tonguing is one of the ways that these trombones can, I didn't bring my trumpet today, but if I were to do that, I can do that without using my tongue, and I'm going to get a natural break in the notes by just pressing the piston valves. Same thing on saxophone by pressing the keys. I mean, and you won't master anything if you don't practice. But I drove, and I was singing all the way down. It's about 4.5 hours. It's really a 5.5 hour drive, but I was 19. Foolish. So. Sometimes become distractions from the things that we need to work on. And if you actually sing the things that you need to work on, then by the time you get to your actual or the practice room, you've actually gotten a lot of the work done. Of course, you still have to apply it to the acts. For you brass players, if you sing and just play it in the mouthpiece, of course, then you have to work on your slide technique, your fingering. I mean, same thing for all the instruments, really. And if you can sing it, then you've internalized it, even if it's a percussion instrument. If you want to play a rhythm, try to sing it first. And if you can sing it, then you can train yourself to play. You just have to be diligent in your practicing. Because see, the hardest part of practicing is not practicing itself. It's just getting to the practice. You have to find a time to practice. You have to find a place to practice, a time and place to practice. You know, a time that is okay. But the thing is, you wake up with and you go to sleep with your voice every night. So even if you're walking across campus, you can sing softly without disturbing anyone. And it's not the maximum way to work, but if you can steal a few moments here or there, it works. So. Singing, when I sing, or when you sing, I'm going to play something on the piano. You're going to hear it coming at you. And if I train myself on the piano enough, then I can look at any piece of music and read and play. So, those things that you know the melodies to or the parts to. sometimes I would just sit down and challenge myself to play the things that I can sing, because now I get a chance to sing much more than, you know, I can sing while I'm driving. I can't play the trombone while I'm driving. It's probably not a good idea anyway. So anyway. Same thing happens with improvisation. I'll give an example before I take the next question. I'm going to sing something. I want you to sing it back. So, again, fellas, Thinking about at least two or three things. When you're singing, you're completely using your ear and your body to connect with the vibrations of the music. Just like you just, you know, like what you just did. You want to learn to play on the blues? You don't have to figure that out. Blues has been played and recorded thousands, maybe even millions of times. Recordings that you can listen to and just learn simple phrases. If you can sing something accurately in tune, that means that you can hear it and that you've internalized it. And once you've internalized something, you can teach it to yourself. And then things like keys no longer matter. Doesn't matter what key it's in, because if you can sing it accurately in tune, then you can probably sing it in any key, starting on any pitch. Because what's important is that you have the relative pitches. So, and it sounds like rocket science, but it's as easy as what you just did. So, next question. Yes, sir.
You look so relaxed when you're playing, and a lot of instrumentalists are trying to avoid tension. Did you ever have to work at trying to relax?
What helped me, again, was becoming comfortable with the music that I was creating. I used to have tension in my body when I played a lot, and I used to blame it on the instrument. Said I was playing a Bach 482. It's a little heavy than this horn here. My arms are tight. And I blamed it on the horn. And what it really was, I just wasn't comfortable musically. When I started singing, I mean, you know, the other things I did for my particular instrument, like breathing exercises, endurance exercises, that will help. Don't get me wrong, singing is a great key. Learning the piano is one of the greatest tools that you can utilize to develop your musical intelligence. But once I started singing, and a combination of those other things, I became comfortable playing music. You know, we talk about playing jazz, classical music, playing through changes. If you master your instrument, you get to a certain level of mastering the instrument, then, you know, learning to play jazz, it's a language. Learning to play orchestral excerpts, classical music, it's a language, it's a style thing. But if you don't master your instrument, then, you know, you're gonna be tense, because you're gonna be thinking about, what do I do here? What do I do here? What next? I'm sight reading. I'm seeing some changes for the first time. I mean, and let's see, my email address is wycliffe@wycliffeorton.com. I work with quite a few classical students that are uncomfortable in the realm of jazz or improvisation. And improvisation is as simple as, you know, we talk about transcriptions, we make it a science, but if we just sing everything first, you can pretty much figure out the rest. You're in class, you're gonna get that. But if you sing first, you'll connect to the music a lot quicker. So when I started singing, I'd be trying to play it on my horn, mastering the mechanics of playing a trombone or a trumpet or a tuba. But when I could sing it, then, you know, I just have to put it on the instrument, because once I can sing it, I got the music. I just have to work it out on here. Oftentimes we're fighting with instruments like the fingering, the key, the chord changes. You start singing things like singing through the chord changes. I sent my email address because of something earlier. I did this. There's a friend of mine did a book called what was it called? The Brass Cookbook, and he called on a lot of brass players to talk about their specialties or a teaching technique or something that they did. And I figured I was one of the only jazz musicians, so I gave an approach to improvisation. And this is a long title right now. It's just, I just say sing it first. But it was a single approach to ear training for jazz improvisation. Basically, it's like a 12-step program. Three main steps. You sing the melody, you sing the roots of the chords, and it's kind of set up, it's called a cookbook, so I did it kind of like a recipe. I had a song, you know, the instrument, you know, ingredients, things that you would need. And I broke it down into, I think in the book it's like 11 steps, and the 12th step is just repeat steps 1 through 11 as needed. But you learn the melody, you can sing the melody, the roots of the chords, and then once you can sing through the chords themselves, anyone can just, rather than trying to figure it out on the instrument, just try to sing and do everything slowly. So back to my initial answer, once I started singing, I began to relax, because now basically I'm challenged to play the things that I can sing. And we're all music students. Start with things that you know. Songs that you know, hymns that you know, scales that you know. And once you start singing, you become a lot more comfortable with playing. And I think that's what happens to you. Next, questions? Yes, sir.
Yeah, I know that you've taught a wide variety of students. How do you help a student find their own voice?
Well, most of the time, students finding their own voice, I find anytime a student asks me a question, I can pretty much, they already know the answer. When you ask them how often they practice, when you get an answer that starts off with, about, or you get an answer that's, it's one of those answers, you can, whatever issues they're dealing with can be fixed with a consistent practice schedule. So I take the students wherever they are. So I have various levels of students, from very mature to beginners from time to time. And what was your question again?
I was asking about helping students find their own voice. Right?
I think that's easy, because our speaking voice, I mean, you think about your speaking voice, that's the one thing that everyone, you know, you may talk like, you say he sounds like he's from somewhere, you can be associated with the region, but your speaking voice, the inflections that each one of us speaks with, makes us the individual that we are. So I think with a regiment of, if you're talking about in jazz, because I think that's one of the highest levels that you can attain in any type of music, is to play with a recognizable sound, like Louis Armstrong, Sidney Bechet. And one thing I do for my students is to play recordings of, you know, folks like that, get them to transcribe solos. If I'm talking about trombone, I'll start out with J.J. Johnson. Not because he's a great trombonist, but in order, not just because he's a great trombonist, it's in order to play, to transcribe one of his solos, you have to have a certain level of technical mastery on the instrument to do it. And if you don't, then okay, let's work on some technique. I mean, most of the time I spend, even with my most advanced students, working with technical issues. It may be something small, and the students that have worked out things where they're playing it so advanced, I actually give them the choice. I said, if you really want to fix that, it's going to take some time, because you ingrain in your muscle memory just by doing it this way. So I'll give you that choice. If you have younger students, I'll say, I want you to work on this technical thing so that you'll be able to execute this. So it'll be J.J. Johnson, because, you know, sometimes his playing is so clean, it sounds like he's playing a valve instrument. And then I'll give them someone like Dickie Wells or Vic Dickinson. And the school of trombone is so wide in itself that even some of my advanced students, I give them trumpet solos to learn. And once they start, I said, but, you know, you can buy the transcription book, but try to play with the inflection that the musician that you're studying is playing with. That way you begin to build up vocabulary. Imitate Frank Rosalino, imitate Louis Armstrong, imitate Miles Davis, imitate Fats Navarro, imitate Jimmy Blanton on the bass, where you can play in those various styles. So then you begin to build up vocabulary, and along the way, if they're actually doing that, they'll find their voice through that. Because I mean, if you think about it, we all learned to talk by imitating someone that we heard. We didn't read a book and learn how to speak. We imitated what our parents said, older brother, sister, the cat, the dog, whatever we heard. We made that sound, and that's how we learn. So if you start by giving them schools of thought in terms of playing, and I like to start with the earlier musicians, because again, that was a thing to be able to play with a recognizable sound and or style. Then, you know, they'll take things that you give them, and if they're really studious, like, I like this, but I like to do it that way. And you can't really teach them to find their own voice. You give them the tools, and you know they'll do it on their own. But I think you have to give them the tools and listen to people like Louis Armstrong. I mean, you know, I was reminded of a story. I flew in Arizona once. A young trucker picked me up from the airport and said, "I want to play for you later, just to get some pointers." I said, "Yeah, sure." Had a late night, didn't sleep. Let me sleep for a couple hours. Come by early afternoon. He came by. played a little bit of this. He played like George Spring and some other things. I was like, man, it's nice playing. I said, you ever listen to or study Louis Armstrong? He said, no. I said, well, why not? He said, well, you know, that's that old jazz. You know, it's the, you mean old as in, well, yeah, it was recorded back in the early 1900s, but his conception was that, well, you know, this is what's hip. And I was like, well, no early jazz, there would be none of this. So, and I think it's important for students at least to expose themselves to the history of the music on the instrument. Like a lot of times when I hear young bass players play, they play the style of bass starting from like in the 60s. All the quarter notes are long, and they don't really understand that the bass took the place of the tuba, and the jazz, early jazz bands that played on 1 and 3, short quarter notes. And even in the early teens and 20s, when they started adding basses to the band, even when you listen to, as far as 1938 to 1941, Duke Ellington's Blanton Webster years, when Jimmy Blanton plays, his quarter notes are still kind of short. Now it's still swinging. He happened to be a great soloist on the instrument, but someone like Wellman Broad. But a lot of times they don't know the history of the instrument, so they play it one way. And helping to learn the history of how the instrument is played, articulated on, and different, you know, style solos, I think that'll help them define their voice, if that's what they're looking for. Because some students, they want to be clones of other folks. And I had a student one time, I said, he just finished his classical degree at Juilliard and wanted to study jazz, and he got into the jazz studies program. And I said, he said, well, I want to work on this, and I want to work on that. I don't remember exactly what it was. I said, okay, all right, well, I'm going to give you some transcriptions. I said, this J.J. Johnson transcription from the trombone master. He said, well, I really don't want to sound like J.J. Johnson. And I said, well, you don't really have to worry about that happening too much. You're probably not going to sound like J.J. Johnson. The thing is, what you're going to get on the way to sounding like J.J. Johnson is going to get you closer to what you want to do. And I think they're learning these solos because of the technique and the technical mastery of the instrument itself that you have to play just to be able to execute it. And, you know, trombone, many instruments have characteristics. I think trombone has the most vocal characteristics, and even though I play trombone, I listen to all, some of my favorite recordings are like Ben Webster with strings, because of the way that he plays the saxophone is so vocal. But like the Dickie Wells Blues, he's a lot more vocal in terms of his approach to playing. Great composers like Hoagie Carmichael would say, who's a, you know, who's written many songs in the Great American Songbook, oftentimes he would say, I wish that I would have written it the way that Louis Armstrong would do it. I mean, you take a tune like Up a Lazy River. Up the lazy river where the oatmeal runs, meet the lazy river by the noonday sun, lingering in the shade of a kind old tree. And then throw away your troubles, dream and dream of me. Pops did it nothing like the melody. He was like, up the lazy river, down by the old mill run. Meet the lazy river by the noonday sun. I'm living in the shade of a kind old tree. Why don't you throw away your troubles and dream a dream of me, dream a dream of me. Up the lazy river, nothing close to the melody. But he wouldn't do all of the songs like that, but even the way that he would phrase when he played or sang Stardust, oftentimes great composers, Pops would make their tunes hits. And, you know, because he was just, he had great command of the time, harmony, and phrasing. Oftentimes, some of the younger generation tend to think, ah, like that young guy, he told me, nah, we should bring him back to my story. That is the old way of playing. I said, the only thing about Miles, I said, I love Clifford Brown. I love Miles Davis. I love all the great trumpet players, Freddie Hubbard, Dizzy, Roy Eldridge. I said, but one thing about Louis Armstrong, only after one or two notes, you know who that is. You don't even have to guess. Let alone if you start singing. And you know, and maybe he didn't like the fidelity of the recording, but the content of the recording is just as new today as it was yesterday. And even though it's not a lot of notes, what's implied in those melodies and what the way that Pops actually played and sang, it's like, you know, I kind of strive for that. So he's, if I had to pick one person, I mean, you know, there are many different trombone players. If I had to pick one trombonist, I probably could, because there's so many different schools of trombone. But, you know, Louis Armstrong was the epitome of music. He was a walking, you know, music machine. You know, there's a singer and there's a trumpeter. More importantly, now for me, Louis Armstrong is one of the greatest humanitarians of all time. You know, I've studied him as a musician earlier, but I get a chance to do education activities and residencies where we work, and like in Chicago, the Louis Armstrong Legacy Project and Celebration, where we expose students to the life and legacy of Louis Armstrong. And of course, we get his music, but you know, the historical things that Louis Armstrong was a part of and what he stood for, just knowing that he came out of the poorest of the poor, and had become one of the most famous people in the world at one point in time. And you know what Duke Ellington said about Pops? Pops went to the top and never hurt anybody along the way, because he always understood that